When working with a job search service, artificial intelligence can improve the experience of your candidates and employers. In the last set of videos, we looked at what the Google Cloud Talent Solution Job Search API offers and gave some general tips for using it. Now, let's write some code and start working with the API itself. In order to use the API, we'll need to go through code using the client libraries, REST interface, or RPC interface. The client libraries are the easiest way to get started, so we'll be using those for any samples here. But the structure is still the same if you want to use the REST or RPC interfaces. We'll be using version 3 of the API for all of our code. Don't forget to check the documentation for the latest updates. First things first, we'll need a Google Cloud Platform project with billing enabled to work from. If you're not sure how to do this, I'd recommend checking out the links in the description first, then coming back to this video when you've got the GCP basics set up. With the GCP project, we can open up the navigation in the top left and look for Talent Solution, which will be under Artificial Intelligence. When we click on Overview, we should get redirected to a screen that asks us to enable the API, since this might be a new GCP project. Easily enough, we can just click that Enable button to turn on the API for the current project. This may take a few minutes, but once it's enabled, anything we do in the context of this project can use the API. Keep in mind that if you want to use multiple projects with the API, you'll need to enable it for each project. After that's done, we'll head back to the Overview page and have a new screen show up, a data logging requirement notification. This is really just making sure you know that the Job Search API is powered by a machine learning model that needs data. As part of the integration, we'll actually be able to send over events from users who are searching to further train those models. When this is implemented through code, you can specify which pieces of information get sent over. We'll dive deeper into what those events are and how to send them later, but the pre-trained models will work just fine for now. So we'll go ahead and enable data logging and click on Service Account Connections. See, when making API requests, you'll need to make them on behalf of an actual authenticated account. Google Cloud Platform's best practices recommend setting up a service account for this. Once again, there's a link in the description for more about service accounts. But think of them as an easy way to set up authenticated users who have limited permissions, so you can build an independent and secure system. We'll need a service account to use the Job Search API. So let's create one and give it read-write permissions using Job Editor under the Cloud Talent Solutions section. It's also possible to set up a service account with just Job Viewer, so it would only have read-only access. One more note to be aware of, especially if you're importing a lot of jobs at once or dealing with a high volume of search requests, you should be aware of quotas. You can see your quotas on the admin page and request increases if needed. If you see an error message related to quota or to jobs still being indexed, the quota page may help to see what's going on. Check out the quota page in the ever-growing link farm down below to see what the default quotas are and how to raise them. Okay, that's enough setup for now. We've got everything we actually need to run some code, so let's do it. We'll use the client libraries in Python, but you can check the docs for code samples in your preferred language. We'll also use the convenient Cloud Shell that you can access through the console. If you're doing this from your own environment, make sure to get the Google Cloud SDK and the client libraries installed. To run the code using the libraries, you just need to make sure some environment variables are set up. One for the project and one for the path to your service account's key file. Let's start off with something simple, just listing all the companies that we have. This is our code on the top and the Cloud Shell on the bottom. You can see that we set up the project ID using the environment variable, and in the list companies function, we'll just list the companies by passing the project ID. Then we'll loop through the results and print them all out. Of course, there's no companies because we haven't created any yet. So let's take a look at how to create a basic company. This function will create a company that's passed in. The request is pretty similar to the last one, but we're calling create with some additional fields. We'll pass in a very basic company with only the required fields, display name and external ID. When we run this, we'll see that the company was created and it has a name, which is a unique identifier used in the API. Now, when we list our companies, we'll see the new one we created as well as its name. See, the name is the unique identifier generated by the Job Search API, while the external ID is the identifier you provide from your own job system. Anytime you refer to an object through the API, you'll need to use the name. We'll talk about that in the next video when we dive more into working with companies. In the meantime, you can always check out the documentation for more info. Thanks for watching, and remember, when looking for talent, it's okay to keep your head in the cloud.